guys. Welcome back to Urban Today. You're still watching Urban Today. My name is Henry Sekanjako. And with me, I've been joined by Jonah Byakutaga. He's a former aspirant, Hoima City, right? Yes. Welcome to the show, Jonah.
Thank you, Henry.
All right, how was it for you?
It was my first experience into elective politics. It wasn't as easy as I thought it was going to be.
Okay.
Or maybe that's even an understatement. But overall, it's been a huge learning curve, but with so many disappointments along the way.
Okay. Mm. What did go, you know, as planned?
Well, to start off with, you know, when you're outside politics, you hear about the stories that are happening in there, and you tend not to believe it's that serious. But when you get in, for me, what was the most disappointing was what happened on voting day. I think the election could have been handled better. As a party, we could have done things different that would have changed. I've seen today we have about 378
petitions. Yeah.
These would not have been there if a few things had been done different. So. To start with, the voter bribery and intimidation were on another level. The person who's presumed to have won the race, or the presumed flag bearer, I say presumed because to me, we don't have a flag bearer yet, at least until our petitions are disposed of. The person who's presumed to have won the race he drove, first of all. He left his polling center and drove to my polling center to try and intimidate me and challenge me to a physical fight. In front of my family, friends, and it was shocking to see. Besides that, they were buying voters off the line. They literally come and hand money. I think we've seen the videos in different places going around. It was not any different in Hoima. They were coming to the lines and paying people to move off the lines. In other cases, they gave out masks the previous night. Now, in those masks, there was 5,000 shillings in every mask that was given. They then went ahead and told the polling agents that, that these are the NRM Secretariat polling agents, and they were told not to allow, in certain areas, not to allow voters who do not have masks. Now, this is not even a directive that was given by the party chairperson or the district chairperson, but they went ahead and eliminated some of my voters who did not have masks, and they would easily identify because he knew the people that he had given masks. So those were some of the challenges. In other cases, voting started at different times. In some polling centers, we started with a women's race, the city woman's seat and the district woman's seat. The race began at 11. By 12, some polling stations started to vote. We now, the male representatives, when the voting started, in some areas, they were still voting women. So it was starting at different times. Now, what would happen is the polling center that's done with voting, they would ferry those voters to the rural polling centers. People voted as many as 4 or 5 times. Children under 18 were voting. It was sad to see.
Sure. Yesterday, the chairperson, NRM Electoral Commission, Mr. Tango Doi, came out to say that he has received quite a number of petitions. But when he looks at these petitions, most of the issues that you guys are raising are pity. He called them pity. And I understand you're one of those that petitioned.
Yes, my petition is actually right here. I received on the 9th of September. But
is your petition among those that are, you know, Tango Doi described as, you know, petty?
Well, to start off with, I haven't had that actual statement. I just had it off air.
Because, he, you know, he raises issues like, you know, my agent was, you know, slapped. My people were pushed out of, you know, the lines.
I'll tell you what. Well, first of all, I haven't heard the statement from the party electoral commission chairperson. But I wouldn't call it petty. If people are being manhandled, physically being beaten, agents are being beaten, are being chased off polling centers, for me that's not petty. I mean, this is a question of life or death. We are lucky in Hoima. We did not have an actual case of violence where people fought. But it was only contained because, for example, there's a polling station in my constituency where I had to ask my agents to walk away. And they refused to sign the declaration forms. If they had stayed there, they would have been beaten. So I wouldn't call that petty. It's unfortunate if that's just the word that was used.
Yeah, that's what you told the media yesterday and it's in the news. If you can get a copy of the New Vision, you can read about it. But then I wanted you to tell us, what are some of those issues that you raised in your petition?
Well, most of them have actually touched on them. The first thing is the voter bribery. I think it's been the president has gone on record to talk about it as well.
Okay.
We have videos showing people being bought on lines. We've spoken about intimidating of voters, chasing them away from the lines because they do not have masks,
okay.
which wasn't an instruction from anywhere, be it the party president or the electoral chairperson of the party. Then we're talking about multiple voting, people using borders and taxis to be ferried from town polling centers to different areas. In some cases, we even had chairpersons who are known to be relatives of the presumed winner actually conducting elections. I don't know how that happened, whether the party was aware that these were their polling agents that were picked, but some of them were conducting the exercise. Fourthly, there was no security whatsoever, and I found that the most disturbing. You cannot have voting going on with potential violence, people are being, and there's absolutely no security at every polling center. We tried to call the RDC's office to request for security. In some cases, he was very, very helpful. He sent security, but I think maybe it wasn't planned well. I don't understand.
So would you say that you know, the party was not prepared enough to have these party primaries?
I don't think,
because when you look at all these irregularities, you know, it comes all down to that.
I wouldn't say that they're not prepared, because even in a national election, we still have challenges. So it's not about the party. I think there were just some oversights that maybe they didn't, as a party, we didn't anticipate how serious some of these actions would be, or some of these decisions would be. With hindsight now, the party is seeing and learning. I presume, or I can imagine, in the next election, 2026, first of all, I don't think the lining up procedure will happen again, because we've seen so many flaws in the system. And I think also in terms of security, that will be an eye-opener. They'll probably have to look at the security issue and plan it better. So I wouldn't say the party failed. I would say there were challenges. Maybe it was an oversight. They didn't anticipate some of these things. It was the lining up is the first time we've done this. I think we did it for the LC1 chairpersons. Mm-hmm. But since then, if you look back, it hadn't happened in quite a while. So doing it on a national level for all elections, it was a new challenge for the party. And I'm sure they've picked up their own lessons from that. We should have... Moving forward, I think we'll see some big changes in the way that the election
is. Some people have come out to say that, okay, try to build the chaos, you know, to the party president, you know, chairman coming out to allow everyone to vote. How did it play out on your side? Do you think non-residents came in and voted, and that it's one of the issues that caused chaos, you know, in your area?
For me personally, I think we should have stuck to the registers. Because there was a time frame that was given for people to register, to register and be allowed to vote. I understand where the president comes from, or the party chairperson comes from, when he says everybody should vote. There was that challenge of COVID. There was a lockdown period where so many people were unable. A big number of my family, for example, were unable, because Hoima is a border district. At some point, the COVID restrictions could not allow people to travel to Hoima and back. So many of potential voters were stuck in Kampala, they couldn't move to Hoima to register. So I understand when he says everybody should vote in that sense, because so many NRM members were unable to register. So he had good intent when he said that. But then again, we probably as a party didn't understand how serious it was going to be when you could see People Power supporters, FDC supporters, people who are known to support different candidates and different parties walk into the line and smilingly voting for a weaker candidate, because they know it's going to be much easier for their candidate come the general election. So with hindsight, again, it was not necessarily the right move to do.
Okay, and what are your prayers in the petition?
For starters, we are young. We're a new generation. I'm only 35. We believe it's now our generation that has to step forward and play their part as the older generation hands over the torch. If we are to keep the younger generation in the party, these petitions have got to be listened to thoroughly. People's concerns have got to be addressed. I don't expect the party to say we shall have re-elections all over the country. But I expect in cases where the arguments are put out clearly and they're quite obvious, a re-election should take place and keep people concerned. Because if we, the young people, believe we can still play our part in NRM, and then we walk away discontent and feeling like our concerns have been called petty, like you said, I don't think it bodes well for the future of the party, because we are going to be the future of the party.
Okay. All right. So we're talking about Hoima City East. Do you want a retali? Do you want a cancellation of the vote? What is that? You want from the electoral, you know, commission to do.
As a candidate, as Byakutaga Jonah, this petition is co-signed with another candidate, the only lady who was in the race with us, called Mpabaisi Dorin, the two of us are asking for a re-election, not a recount. The recount as well, when you look at some, when I look at my DR forms that are handed back to my agents, and I look at the overall results that were given, the numbers are distorted. They don't match up. We want a re-election because we believe the person who holds the flag did not win it in a fair way, does not deserve his. His candidature is not a reflection of what the people on ground actually want. So we want a re-election. We want to lose free and fair if we're going to lose.
Tango Doyle has said that they're not going to cancel an election. What is your take on this?
Well, again, it's something that's on his table. We have not yet got official communication. We have done our part. We have put the petitions in. We wait now. If he responds, then we shall make our decision based on the response that we get. I'm not going to preempt his judgment. I'm just going to wait for the verdict that comes out. Whatever ruling comes out, then we will respond according to how we see fit.
Do you see the hearing process, you know, being fair, free and fair?
I want to think so. I want to think so.
Because we have seen ministers run to the president instead.
Well,
meaning they're not, they don't trust the, you know, Tango Doyle and then the 14 lawyers that have been put up to listen to this, to, you know, to look at these petitions.
I don't think it's that they don't trust Tango Doyle. I think they do trust him, but they worry that he might be overwhelmed by the number of cases. So perhaps that's why they've gone to the party chairperson. We haven't appealed to the party chairperson. We've gone to the man in charge of the election. If we get a verdict that we feel we're not content with, maybe we shall also consider moving it, escalating it to the party chairperson.
And then lastly from you, are you standing as an independent?
Again, that's too early to say. Like I said, I'm waiting for the verdict of the petitions. We expect that in the next 2 weeks before the end of this month. When the verdict comes out, we shall make our decision at that point.
All right, Jonah, thank you very much for joining us and, sharing us, with us what happened in Hoima City. We hope the NRM Electoral Commission, you know, listens to people and then sorts out those issues. All right, we'll be going for a break, and then when we come back, we'll be having the president, Paul Lugambo, Joseph Atiseguya.